Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus. Welcome to this worship of the United Methodist Church of Westport and Weston. I'm Pastor Heather Sinclair, and it's a blessing to welcome you to this time where we can worship God together. If you are watching this at 9:30 a.m. on April 26th, then you are watching the premiere of this video. A premiere video on YouTube means that you can use the right-hand side chat bar to send a greeting to others who might be watching, to add a comment, or to post a prayer request. I would remind you that that chat bar becomes archived along with the video, and so I suggest that you use first names only for privacy reasons. Following worship this morning, there will be a time of Zoom fellowship at 10:15 a.m. If you have not already received that link, please send me an email, a text, write a message over in that chat bar, and I will get you that link at the conclusion of the service. On Wednesday evening at 7:30, we will continue our book study of Adam Hamilton's Unafraid. We'll talk about fears and challenges and the hope that God gives us in those situations. It's a very fitting study for this time, and I hope that you will continue to join us. A Zoom link will also be sent out for that. Today is Native American Ministries Sunday on the United Methodist Church calendar. Some of the prayers today come from the Native American tradition, from the United Methodist Book of Worship. The imagery of creation in these prayers also ties beautifully with the celebration of Earth Day. We remember today the gifts and sacrifices of our Native siblings and pray that we may repent of the harm and the injustices done to their communities. The United Methodist Church supports Native American ministries throughout the country, and you can learn more about those ministries at umcgiving.org. I invite you to take a moment to breathe deep and to center yourself as we begin our worship.
Thank you, Heather, and good morning, everyone. Please join us in the call to worship.
I love the Lord.
I will call upon the name of the Lord.
The Lord listens to my voice and my prayers.
I will call upon the name of the Lord.
Even when disease and distress surround me,
I will call upon the name of the Lord.
The Lord gives me freedom and protection.
I will call upon the name of the Lord.
I will give thanks to the Lord always.
Praise the Lord.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands that wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me. Spirit divine, open my ears that I may hear voices of truth thou sendest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, I will to see. Open my ears, illumine me. Spirit divine, open my mouth and let me bear gladly the warm truth everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children thus to share. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, I will to see. open my heart, illumine me. Spirit divine.
Let us pray together the prayer of confession. O great Spirit, whose voice we hear in the winds and whose breath gives life to all the world, hear us. We come before you as your children. We are small and weak. We need your strength and wisdom. Let us walk in beauty and make our eyes ever behold the red and purple sunset. May our hands respect the things you have made, our ears be sharp to hear your voice. Make us wise, so that we may know the things you have taught your people, the lessons you have hidden in every leaf and rock. We seek strength not to be superior to our brothers and sisters, but to live in harmony with ourselves and all of your creation. Help us to be ever ready to come to you, so that when life fades as a fading sunset, our spirits may come to you without shame. Amen. Hear these words of assurance from the Psalms. In the presence of the Lord, there is fullness of joy. In God's hands are pleasures forevermore. Christ gave his life so that we might know joy and pleasure in new life. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Peace be with you. Let us share the peace of Christ with others. Amen.
Hi, good morning. We have been doing a little more baking than usual in our house during these days, and I love to bake. I like to eat baked goods, but I also always really like to share what I've baked. And that may not be quite as easy these days, but it did remind me of the part of the story that is our gospel reading today, when Jesus walks with his friends on the road to Emmaus, but they don't know that it's Jesus. They're confused and they haven't recognized him yet. But then when they go and they sit down at the dinner table, he takes bread, he blesses it, he breaks it, and when he breaks the bread to share it with them, they recognize him. Jesus is with us when we share love, when we share friendship, when we share bread or share a meal together. So I hope that you are sitting down with family these days and enjoying a meal together. Maybe if you can't sit down with family, you can call them on the phone or FaceTime with them while dinner is on the table. Just as I was about to film this, one of you stopped by with a beautiful bake good. I'll show off your beautiful creation, which got me to thinking about what a gift it is to share. So maybe you can share a baked good that you've made in your home with someone else. In whatever ways that you share the love of God today, remember that God is with you, God is loving you, and God is caring for you. Let us pray. Dear God, we give you thanks for the ways you share your love with us. Remind us to share love, to share bread, to share friendship with others around us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. I'm reading from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 35. This takes place on the day of the resurrection of Jesus. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you. For you are our rock and risen Redeemer. Amen. The news these days is filled with numbers, staggering numbers of illness and death. But for every number, we remember that there is a person, a child of God. And for every person, someone, from the nurse at their bedside to a family and friends and a community, grieves the death of that child of God. Grief is a strange and surprising emotion. Grief puts us in a mental, emotional, and even physical fog. Grief wakes you up in the morning, assuming that you have been able to sleep, with an empty feeling in the pit of your stomach. Gradually, as you awake, you remember how that emptiness came to be, and the grief comes rushing back. Day by day, the feeling lightens a little, but the fog still hangs. I imagine that is how the disciples felt as they walked the road to Emmaus. They were dazed and confused and fogged by their grief. It was only Sunday evening. Their friend, teacher, and mentor, Jesus, had died brutally and tragically midday on Friday. Nothing felt real. Especially the unbelievable tale that the woman had told them that morning. The tomb was empty? How could that be? Where had they taken his body? For reasons not told by Luke, a couple of the disciples began the 7-mile walk to Emmaus in a daze, unaware of who was walking with them. As travelers might do, they began to tell the story of their journey, and the stranger asked questions about what had taken place in Jerusalem. Bewildered, the disciples answered and told him of the mighty deeds and words contrasted by the tragic condemnation, crucifixion, and confusion of the empty tomb. Then the profound phrase, "We had hoped." The disciples walked with broken hopes. They had hoped. Hopes of who Jesus could have been and what he could have done. Hopes that he would not have to die. Hopes that he would continue to preach and teach and heal. Hopes that he would be the Messiah, the one to valiantly ride into Jerusalem on a royal horse, not a donkey, and save them all from the oppression of the Romans. It's crushing to have your hopes go unheard and unanswered and unfulfilled. We've all felt that disappointment and pain. When hopes are shattered, the future seems unclear. In this season, how many things have we hoped for gatherings, for graduations, for games, for groceries, and goodbyes that have not and will not be realized in this season? We had hoped, but instead we leave those hopes behind. The disciples, leaving their hopes behind, kept walking, still unaware of who walked with them. And then this stranger calls them foolish for not believing, for not remembering the scriptures. Of course they remembered the scriptures. They remembered all the things that the scriptures said that God had done for God's people. They remembered the stories of freedom. They remembered the promises of protection. They remembered that God's prophets proclaimed that one would come to bring salvation to all. They remembered, but they wondered if God had forgotten. If I was one of those disciples on the Emmaus Road, I would have been frustrated, maybe even angry. Grief has an interesting way of going from denial to anger in a matter of seconds. I would have been annoyed by this stranger who assumed to know what I thought and felt in my grief. A reminder that listening is sometimes the best, the only thing we can do when another person is in grief. This man who thought he knew everything but didn't even know what happened in Jerusalem that morning. Who did he think he was? And yet, there was something appealing, perhaps even familiar about him. So the disciples invited him to dinner, extended the hospitality that their friend Jesus had done so many times before, even to the stranger, the sinner, the lost, and the lonely. Of all the things that seemed to be unclear to the disciples, in the midst of their heavy grief, the call to offer hospitality and welcome is the one thing that is clear. Perhaps that's why I've always loved this story, that gift of hospitality and welcome. And perhaps it's why it's even harder to preach this story in this season. The core of Jesus' teaching is to love, to welcome, to embrace others in the midst of their suffering and pain and grief. And we cannot do those things in the usual ways right now. We cannot fully love and care and welcome each other in the ways that we always have. I cannot fully pastor in the ways I always have. And for that, there is great grief. Like the disciples, we had hoped. We had hoped for so many things that cannot be fulfilled right now. We are separated and isolated from each other so that when this storm passes, we can return to loving and caring for each other. We are loving each other by not embracing each other. And here, my friends, is the good news. In the midst of sadness and grief and isolation, Jesus shows himself to the disciples. He comes to them exactly when and where and how they needed him most, even when they did not recognize him. And in that moment, Jesus did one of the most Jesus-like things to do. He blesses and breaks and shares the bread, just as he had a few nights before. Take, eat. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the breaking of the bread, they recognize him and they rejoice. Christ is risen and Christ is with them. In that same hour, the disciples leave the table, the company of their Emmaus friends, and rush back, 7 miles back, to Jerusalem, to tell the 11 that they have seen the Lord. Easter faith can be both a resurrection hope and a lamenting restlessness at the same time, writes preacher Matthew Skinner. Easter isn't always the end of disappointment. In this Easter season, the journey on the road to Emmaus, the journey of wrestling with grief, seems longer. Like kids in the back seat on a road trip, we're asking, are we there yet? No, not yet. In our car, we like to say 5 more minutes, regardless of the distance. Are we there yet? No. We don't know how much longer we are on this journey because we cannot see the clear end. And that is frustrating and sad and at times overwhelming. But as Easter people, we affirm that Easter is a promise that our faith will carry us through the journey. As Hebrews 11:1 states, faith is the reality of what we hope for, the proof of what we do not see. Faith guides us on the journey, through the joys, the surprises, the struggles, and the grief. Faith assures us that Christ walks with us each step of the way, whether or not we are fully aware of his presence. Christ invites us to wrestle with our grief, reminds us of the presence of God throughout our story and the history of God's people. And Christ does not leave our side. Friends, whether we are together or apart, we are on this journey together as siblings in Christ. Care for yourself in your grief. Care for your companions along the way. Have hope, for this journey, though unknown, will turn in a better direction, and we press on with Jesus as our goal. Above all, open your hearts and your eyes to the presence of Christ who walks with you, gracing you with love and peace. Amen.
Thank you.
names of those who we know and love. We lift up situations in our communities and around the world. Most especially, we pray for those who grieve today. We pray for the family of Haynes Farmer, who passed earlier this week, longtime member of this congregation, choir member, and so many other roles in this place. And we pray for Pat and for his whole family. We pray for the Buchholz family on the passing of Jeanette, for the Glass family on the passing of William Glass Sr., for the Liu family on the passing of Dan's mother, Taemin. We pray for all of those who grieve around the world. We pray for those who are seeking healing. We give thanks for those who are experiencing the healing miracles of God, most especially Pastor John Esposito and Reverend Jim Stinson. We give thanks for their continued healing. As we pray this morning, I invite you to lift in your hearts the names of those who you know and love. This prayer is inspired by Chief Seattle, a Native American, and it reminds us yet again of this Native American Sunday, of our relationship with the earth and with our brothers and sisters. Let us pray. Every part of the earth is sacred. Every shining pine needle, every sandy shore, every mist in the dark woods, every clearing and humming insect is holy. The rocky crest, the meadow, the beasts and all the people, all belong to the same family. Teach your children that the earth is our mother. O God, guide us as we seek to teach our children well, to respect the earth and each other, to care for the earth and each other, to love and lead with compassion and the recognition that we are all children of God. Whatever befalls the earth befalls the children of the earth. We are part of the earth, and the earth is part of us. O God, may we cherish our connectedness, living and serving in ways that honor you and each other, being stewards of the gifts we have received. The rivers are our brothers, they quench our thirst. The perfumed flowers are our sisters. The air is precious, for all of us share the same breath. The wind that gave our grandparents breath also receives their last sigh. O God, we grieve for those who have taken their last breath. Be with their loved ones in their sorrows. Comfort them in their grief. Fill their hearts with thanksgiving for the life that was and the promise of the life that is to come through the risen Christ. The wind gave our children the spirit of life. This we know, all things are connected. Like the blood which unites our family, all things are connected. O God, in our connectedness, keep us focused on you. Remind us that you walk with us, that we are never alone, and that we are never without the compassion and grace of Jesus Christ. Give us hands, hearts, and voices to connect with others and to share the message of your forgiving and reconciling love. For our God is the same God, whose compassion is equal for all. For we did not weave the web of life and the circle that connects us. Thanks be to God, the God of all. We pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
friends, we do not know how long the journey will be. We do not know where the journey takes us. But we know, we believe, we trust in Christ who journeys with us. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forever.